just, O Lord, and your judgment is right. Treat your servant in accord with your merciful love. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The Lord be with you. Brethren, we gather here after 18 months in this Church of St. Mary's, joyful and happy that we were able to do so even under the social distancing and restrictions that we still encounter, but joyful nonetheless in the prospect of entering this beautiful and sacred space to worship God as He wills. And it's right and just that we reoccupy, refill this space so long consecrated to such beautiful prayer. Brethren, let us acknowledge our resources and prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess, O Almighty God,
A reading from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. Thus says the Lord, you, son of man, I have appointed watchmen for the house of Israel. When you hear me say anything, you shall warn them for me. If I tell the wicked, O wicked one, you shall surely die, and you do not speak out to dissuade the wicked from his way, the wicked shall die for his guilt, but I will hold you responsible for his death. But if you warn the wicked, trying to turn him from his way, and he refuses to turn from his way, he shall die for his guilt, but you shall save yourself. The word of the Lord.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, owe nothing to anyone except to love one another. For the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. The commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not kill, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and whatever other commandment there may be, are summed up in this saying, namely, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no evil to the neighbor. Hence, love is the fulfillment of the law. The word of the Lord. Jesus said to his disciples, if your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he listens to you, you have won over your brother. If he does not listen, take one or two others along with you, so that every fact may be established on the testimony of two or three witnesses. If he refuses to listen to them, tell the church. If he refuses to listen even to the church, then treat him as you would a Gentile or a tax collector. Amen, I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Again, amen, I say to you, if two of you agree on earth about anything for which they are to pray, it shall be granted to them by my heavenly Father. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, there I am in the midst of them. The Gospel of the
When I got here a year ago to serve at St. Mary's at the beginning of August, we were hoping to have this church open for Easter. Then we were hoping to have it open at the end of May. Then we were hoping to have it in midsummer. And here we are, a bit off schedule, but never off of God's schedule. He who from before all time knew all that would take place in this year, who knew when I got here in August last year that we would be celebrating an Easter vigil in an empty church with some of you, many of you, walking through the camera. He knowing the hardships that would fill up this year in its fullness. And so would be here that to love one another means to fulfill the law. We can see it in two different ways. The first is to take fulfillment, as we often do. Oh, that's fulfilled. We're done with that. Oh, we're fine. And the idea being that the people who loves is to fulfill the law, so there's no need to live up to the prescripts of the law. But you'll notice that is not what St. Paul is saying. He's giving another sort of fullness. A fullness more like what we have experienced this year. A very demanding kind of fullness. Namely this, that to love your neighbor as yourself includes the commandments. It's not that it dispenses with them. To not commit adultery means to truly love others. To not kill means to truly love others. To not steal means to truly love others. To not covet means to truly love others. And when all are held in due proportion and weight and are lived out in their fullness to the dynamic, the grace, and the measure that God would have us do, that we might grow to that perfect model of Christ's own charity, it is then that we can say that we love truly. It is then that we can say that we act rightly. And so, fulfillment here doesn't mean dispensing. The same way that, I don't know, turning 18 means you no longer have to ask your mother to drive you somewhere, you know, that is fulfilled. No, that's abrogate, that's done. Hopefully you have your own car, hopefully you're driving responsibly. Not my job, you deal with it. But when we talk about fulfillment here, we're talking rather about coming to the fullness of perfection. And so it is that when we understand what it means to love lightly, like fully, we know how to love rightly, it is that fullness, it's an abundance that is rightly ordered and full measure, satisfying, flowing over, that sort of a fullness. We've all been there before. After a great meal, after a wonderful conversation, when you realize nothing more need be said. After a wonderful homily, where you think he knocked it out of the park, stay tuned, we'll see if I get there. But suffice it to say that we've seen those times of fulfillment. We've experienced those times of fulfillment. And in this year, where we've had to do more with less,
because we're going without so much socialization with others, because we're going without our ordinary human interaction and scout meetings or sports events or even school for some, the fact is that we can be rightly trained in our appetites and our desires now, even as we hunger for that fulfillment, that we can see what we're looking forward to, reckon with what we're looking forward to, savor then what we're looking forward to when it comes. And it is in that way that we fulfill the law, not in the sense of satisfying a requirement, but as in satisfying an appetite, that longing of the heart that yearns to love fully, to give fully, to receive the full measure of love and awareness that every human heart needs. That's the kind of fulfillment we're talking about. It's more of a Denny's Grand Slam and less of a traffic ticket. And it's in this sense that Christ presents to us the need to be ready to correct. Because correction can often be seen as a negative, quite often not mistaken as a negative. That we correct those who annoy us. Nothing new. You have brothers and sisters. I had a sister too, I still do. And that would indeed happen. That correction often happens when people annoy us, or get in our way, or tick us off. But notice what Christ phrases, how he phrases it. If your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he listens to you, you have won over your brother. This isn't about getting him to pay his price. This isn't about getting him simply to mind his P's and Q's. It's about winning over your brother. It's about coming to the fullness, the full measure of charity that Christ has in store for your brother and for you. And no doubt, many of you in marriages, many of you who have had to do this with correction, know it can be a very fraught thing. Maybe you haven't done it because it's a very fraught thing, and quite understandably. But know that Christ commands us to start one-on-one. Often people come to me saying, I gossip too much. I gossip about people at work. I gossip about the family. I gossip about this. And one thing I try to point out to them at times is, well, have you ever tried to talk to the person himself? Because often we end up talking about others because we don't feel comfortable talking to the person himself. And the dissatisfaction, the lack of fullness, the emptiness that we experience is diverted elsewhere. It spills over into places where it doesn't belong. As one spiritual director put it to me, imagine a tube of toothpaste, and you know the toothpaste is supposed to come out the front. But when you cap it, and you cap it tight, and you keep squeezing, that toothpaste is going to come out somewhere it should, as any of us probably know from experience. And so, to be able to correct, and correct properly, not a desire for peace or comfort on our part, but a desire for the well-being of our neighbor, is an essential part of what it means to love in its fullness. To fulfill the commandments means to be ready to help others do so. To fulfill the commandments means to be ready to going from one person, if he does not listen, or to go to two or three, to try to get a group of people, to try to give the person a sense of a fuller story, this fullness to which I live. The idea that many of us cope, that you can pull a few people together and say, I know you've been trying to do it this way, we understand, but trust me, we're looking on, it's not going as well as you think. To know that, and to be invited to understand that, primarily this is meant to be private, to stay as small and local as possible, that the fullness be one-on-one first, then invited within a small group to try to help the person come to see it. And if it's serious enough, and the person obstinate enough, then it come before the whole community. If it's something that serious, if it's something that big, that's what Christ seems to have written here, and you need to know. At the end of the day, we don't always love perfectly. We don't always succeed at loving as fully as we ought. But to even refuse to listen on how we might love better risks missing the point entirely. And so Christ warns that if someone refuses to listen even to the church, then you are to treat him as you would a Gentile or a tax collector. That doesn't mean shun him. That doesn't mean treat him badly. Christ treated Gentiles and tax collectors better.
someone has closed himself off to the point of admitting any possibility of improvement, any possibility of issue. Again, he might have his own opinion, and he might have a right to it, but when someone closes off the possibility of even changing, the very prospect of having a shared life is considerably undermined, diminished, cut off. And so whatever you bind on earth, he promises, will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loose in heaven. We're not saved on our own. We're saved in the church. We're saved by the ministry that we receive one from another. Yes, properly from divine worship here in this church and churches throughout the world through the power of sacraments, but also through the transforming friendships of marriage and other close friendships that are meant to linger and last over the years and help us to grow into the full measure, the fullness that we are meant to enjoy. And so Christ promises that where two or three are gathered in his name, there he is in the midst of them. This isn't simply some sympathetic or emotional appeal. It's a statement of cold, hard fact. Because it's not simply our desires or proclivities that draw us together, but rather Christ, who governs all things, and through whom all things are made and remade. And so every time we gather one to another, every time we open our hearts in prayer, and are open in our ears to see what might be lacking, to see what might be left for fulfillment, we are being prepared for that ministry that Christ intends. We are being prepared to recognize him in our midst, directing us through those we love, to come to that fuller measure of love. This church reflects this pattern. We see on the archways going down in the midst of the nave where you're sitting, various images of Our Lady, the fleur-de-lis that girds these different arches, and the Marianne that reflects her name. Indeed, this church is Mary's church. But when you look over this arch of the main sanctuary, if you look closely, you'll see IHS, the Holy Name, Jesus Christus, Jesus Christ. And so, just as this is Mary's church here and our Lord's sanctuary here, the two united perfectly in this building, so many stones are gathered together to build this church, many facets made to build this church. It's seen also with the rondelles of the different saints, whom I believe Father John Paul will point out to you a little later. All of them have great Marian devotion. In a sense, they have helped build this church through their prayers, their intercession, their example. But you yourself have helped build this church, yes, with your contributions, but also with your prayers and your presence. All of this coming together, all of these different patterns and paints and designs coming together to crown this church for prayer, for your benefit here, all of it meaning to lift your minds and hearts in communion with the saints depicted, in communion and realization of the mysteries that take place here. All of it beautiful to draw your minds to God, who is worthy of your total attention. But ultimately, the easiest way to make a church beautiful is to fill it with people. To fill a church with people means that God has gathered us here, not simply for a common experience of an hour, but for a common life shared in sacraments, a common life shared in prayer. And in this time where we've had to do more with less, where we've had to look at Mass on a TV screen, or offer Mass in front of a camera, we felt the pain that separation entails. We felt the emptiness that comes with that. But the reopening of this church is a sure sign for us, just as the packed pews are, though socially distanced, the packed pews are, of the fullness we are meant to enjoy, one with another, because all of it reflects Christ's fullness, and in him, all fullness is pleased to dwell, fulfilling the full measure of the law, fulfilling the full measure of our lives, and fulfilling the full measure of our hearts, making them as beautiful as this church has been built, making them as beautiful as you yourselves testify by being here assembled, itself a beautiful sight, each reflecting the other and moving toward that full image that Christ has intended for us from the foundation of the world itself. Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. peace, let us pray to the Lord. Let us pray for our Holy Father, Pope Francis, our Bishop, Leonard Blair, and all the bishops of the Church, that they may lead us with the charity of the Good Shepherd. For this, let us pray to the Lord. Let us pray for our civil leaders and all in authority, that they may work for true and abiding peace among all nations, and for the rapid extirpation of the worldwide pandemic. For this, let us pray to the Lord. Let us pray for those facing any particular need this day, for the sick and the suffering, for the homeless and the homebound, for the unborn and their mothers and fathers, for the radically handicapped, the dependent aged, and all who care for them. Let us pray to the Lord. Let us pray also for those facing unemployment at this time, that they, through the grace of God and the mercy of their neighbors, may be able to live a fitting way of life as they await the return of the robust economy that will allow them to contribute to the common good of society. For this, let us pray to the Lord. Let us pray also for those who may be disaffected with the truth, disaffected with the Church, often on account of the scandalous lives of those who profess our faith, often on account of the mixed messages that they may well have received from those entrusted with transmitting the full measure of the faith to them, that they and all of us may work towards true and enduring reconciliation by the full and unsparing proclamation of the gospel in mercy and invitation. For this, let us pray to you. Let us pray also for those who will die this day, that to whatever degree they might be alienated from God or neighbor, the Lord in his love and mercy may enlighten their minds and inflame their hearts towards some true reconciliation as they depart from this world. For this, let us pray to the Lord. And let us pray for all the faithful departed, that through the power of the cross of Calvary, the sacrifice of Calvary, be applied in our moment, in our place, here and now. That all the faithful departed, especially in the Knights of Columbus, deceased, their wives, and Columbian squires, may come to see the face of God. For this, let us pray to the Lord. Heavenly Father, when your Son hath promised us, ask that you shall receive, seek and you shall find, knock and the door shall be opened to you. Grant we pray answer to our petitions, for we make them in the confidence and in the boldness of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever.
Thank you.
chagrin that through this offering we may do fitting homage to your divine majesty, and by partaking of the sacred mystery, we may be faithfully united in mind and heart through Christ our Lord. Spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ, your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty the gifts that you have given us, this pure victory, this holy victory, this spotless victory, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them as ones who are pleased to accept them. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Our first time here is to learn about the communion logistics. My father and I will start in the center aisle, and so at the beginning, only those in the very center sections will go. The ushers will come to their rows, and the ushers will actually begin in the back row and work forward. As your row is inviting to come out, please come on the center aisle, single file line, socially distanced, receive from one or the other of us, and then return back to your pews by looping around all the way to the back of the church. After we've got the whole center sections from back to front, Father and I will go then to the side aisles, and similarly, the ushers will begin dismissing from the back row and come forward up the side aisles, receive, and return to your seats then down the center. Just follow the directives of the ushers, everything perfectly smoothly.
you, Christ.
Grant that your faithful, whom you nourish and endow with life through
so benefit from your beloved Son's great gifts that we may merit an eternal share in his love, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Volunteers to help disinfecting the pews. So if you're not in a high risk COVID He's about a half dozen of you. All the disinfecting supplies are on the front left. And as a way of helping that out, because this is such a bigger church than St. Joseph's, if you're in a pew today, please leave the kneeler down when you exit. And that will be the signal. We'll have all of our disinfectors only be disinfecting the pews where the kneelers are down. Thank you very much.
St. Michael.